and thank you for joining us this evening. I think you are in for a very special evening. Our speaker, Dr. Thomas Hatfield, has many insights to share on Tarleton's alumnus and World War II hero, James Earl Rudder. So we'll get started now. My name is Donna Savage, and I serve as a university librarian here at Tarleton State University. Tonight's lecture is a part of a year-long centennial celebration as the founding member of the Texas A&M University system. This evening is sponsored in part by the Friends of the Dick Smith Library and the Centennial Steering Committee. I know that there are many friends in the audience tonight, and as well as Centennial Steering members, so I'd like you to take a moment to thank them for their support. Could you stand and we'll give them a little hand? I also want to express my appreciation to Dr. Kyle McGregor, Vice President for Advancement and External Relations, and Sabra Gira, Assistant Vice President for Advancement and External Relations, and their terrific team for putting this event together. Great job, folks. Thank you so much. In a moment, we'll hear from our featured guest, and after his lecture, you'll have an opportunity to ask him some questions. So start thinking now what you might like to ask him or as he talks later. Also, at the end of this evening, he will be available to sign his book, Rudder, From Leader to Legend. You may have brought one with you, and if you did, great, you can get it signed. But if you didn't, we do have books for sale. They're $30, I believe, and $15 of every book purchase will go to the Friends of the Dick Smith Library Scholarship Endowment. So this is a chance. We hope you'll take an opportunity. We hope you'll take an opportunity to help support our Tarleton students. I don't have the opportunity very often to introduce the university president, so it is an honor to present him at one of our signature centennial events this evening. Under the leadership of President F. Dominic DeTavio, Tarleton continues to flourish with new and renovated facilities, innovative and expanded academic programs, and new scholarship and research dollars. The list just goes on and on, folks. But most predominantly, Dr. DeTavio has always been an advocate and champion for the university's most important population, our students. And I might add that to the students, Dr. D, as they like to call him, he's Tarleton's rock star. Ladies and gentlemen, Tarleton State University's 15th president, Dr. F. Dominic DeTavio.
Kyle normally introduces me, Dr. McGregor. I think we found somebody else that we could lean on to do this. That was very, very kind of you. Well, thanks to all of you for coming out this evening for what we consider to be a very special event. I want to express my appreciation, as Donna already has, to the Friends of the Library and certainly the Centennial Committee for making this evening's event possible, and certainly for the entire year's events surrounding the centennial. For the students particularly, I want you to hear this because it's important for you to understand that celebrating a 100-year anniversary, whatever kind of anniversary it is for a university, in this case, as a member of the Texas A&M University system, it's really important to us, and we are trying to emphasize this throughout the year because it truly provides us an opportunity to reflect on who we've been. And that's what tonight's program is about, reflecting back on a prominent alumni and the importance that he has had in military history and education, beginning right here at Tarleton. But it's also an important time for us to think about our future. We've been doing some growing, we've been adding programs, buildings, a variety of things, but the future of Tarleton over the next 100 years is something that we always have to be thinking about. And so a centennial anniversary event provides us that opportunity to look back and to look forward at the same time. Our centennial this year began with what was a simple but very dignified and respectful event, flag raising in front of the cannon with that historic flagpole at the Howell Building, provided to us by the ROTC and the Corps of Cadets, newly activated Corps of Cadets. We then moved on and did a dedication on a piece of property that was donated to Tarleton by the city of Stephenville to make the merger with Texas A&M a reality out at the Agricultural Center. And that's significant because it was in 1917 that we became John Tarleton Agricultural College for 50 some years. So that was an important event for us. And then Anthony Purcell and the Department of Fine Arts did a fabulous job of presenting us with a concert that reflected on 1917 and reflected on the core values of this university. So this is a series of events that really gives us an opportunity to celebrate important events, important traditions, important people that have made this university possible over the years. Tonight we have the opportunity to reflect on somebody that was both a Tarleton plowboy, I see the basketball players here, Texans today, but a plowboy during his time, and an A&M Aggie, somebody that did great things at both institutions and made a significant difference in the lives of both these universities. This year, the culminating event of this centennial celebration is going to be the dedication of Rudder Way, the person that we're celebrating tonight. Rudder Way is what I call the big dig taking place out on campus right now, what's torn up on Vanderbilt, where we have what looks like a little New York tunnel between streets out there. Eventually, that's going to be a fabulous new pedestrian walkway called Rudder Way. It's going to celebrate the core values of this university that are tied to General Rudder and the great history that he has, both as an educator and a military hero. And when we celebrate that, it's going to be something that is important to us because for the first time in our history, we will have commemorated one of the most significant alumni of this university, James Earl Rudder. And I see Dr. Hatfield has up here different places that, and I think there are more actually, that have already named something after Earl Rudder. They go from the United Kingdom to Germany to France, Austin, San Antonio, College Station, Bryan, his hometown of Eden. So there are a lot of places that have dedicated important markers after General Earl Rudder. This year, we're finally going to give the man due for the incredible impact that he's had on this country and on this university. I think Dr. Hatfield probably said it best when people say, well, why Rudder? Why Rudder? Here's a quote. I hope I don't steal any of your thunder, but here's a quote from his book that says it as well as anything. Because he rose from obscurity and deprivation in the American heartland to be widely admired by heads of state, soldiers, mechanics, and scholars. Because he combined hard-headed leadership with altruistic motives for service to others. Because his life illustrates the supreme importance of community and family in character formation. And because his accomplishments are proof that in a free society where education is accessible to all, greatness can come from anywhere. Ladies and gentlemen, it's important to understand from this place, Tarleton State University, greatness can come. It came for Earl Rudder, and it can come for each and every one of you. That's the reason why we're celebrating Earl Rudder, and it's the reason why we're so pleased to have Dr. Hatfield here this evening to tell us about the impact of a true American hero. Thank you all so very much for coming this evening.
Thank you, Dr. Tavio. I appreciate that. It's my pleasure to introduce our speaker tonight, Dr. Thomas Hatfield. Dr. Hatfield is the director of the Military History Institute in the Dolph Bresco Center for American History at the University of Texas of Austin, where he is also Dean Emeritus of Continuing Education. After earning his MA in History and PhD from UT Austin, he was a college president for 8 years and is President Emeritus of Austin Community College. At UT Austin, Hatfield was a co-founder of the Normandy Scholar Program, an undergraduate honors program focused on World War II. He is the author of Rudder, From Leader to Legend, which we'll hear a lot more about this evening. He is also the co-author of On the Way, The Life and Times of Frank Dennis, and Dr. Hatfield's study of Texas during the historic drought of the 1950s is primary source material for water resource planners across the state. As a teenager, Dr. Hatfield enlisted in the Texas Army National Guard. He was honorably discharged as a captain in military intelligence. Today, his hobbies include organizing and leading tours across battlefields of the Second World War in Normandy, the Ardennes, Italy, and the islands of the Pacific Ocean. As a historian of the war, he has made guest appearances on the History Channel, PBS, the Discovery Channel, and the American Heroes Channel. In addition, Dr. Hatfield serves as an advisor to the Tom Leia Institute and owns and operates a historic family ranch near his hometown of Medina, Texas. He has been married to Carol Sutherland for 57 years. They have 2 daughters and 6 grandchildren. He is a very busy man, folks. Please help me welcome Dr. Hatfield to the podium.
Well, thank you for that, Donna. And before you step down, I want to present you with a box, and I think a gilded, that means gold, with some gold in it, copy of Rudder, From Leader to Legend, which was a special edition done by the publisher, the Texas A&M University Press. And you can use this as you wish. I'm thinking of it as a gift, really, for the friend of the library, and you may either put it in your archives, or you may use it for fundraising. I have seen this book on, say, Amazon.com on sale for as much as $2,000. Now, for some reason, Amazon sort of plays around with their prices, and so you may see $2,000 one day, and the next day you see $200. So I make no assertion as to the value of this book, but it is a boxed copy, and it is for you and to benefit the library.
Thank you.
Well, first I want to apologize to those of you who've already sat through listening to me. Not once today, but twice today, and now you do 3 times. I kind of feel like, was it Greta Garbo, the actress, who after she'd been married 6 or 7 times, and she had a new husband, and you know the old line he said, I know what's expected of me, I just don't know how to make it interesting. But I thank you really very much for that introduction. Being married 57 years, and I have yet to go to an attorney to ask for a divorce, but a divorce attorney told me this story about a woman who came to him and asked for his help to get a divorce. And he asked her, well, do you have grounds? And she said, no, we live in an apartment. And then he said, well, you do have a grudge. And she said, no, we have a lovely carport. And then he said, well, why do you want this divorce? And she said, you simply cannot communicate with that man. You see. So, any normal person would be very grateful for the reception that I have had here today. And I am very grateful for it, for the invitation, for the honor of being here. I'm not surprised at the warmth and the hospitality that I have received. It is not only that I've had it before, never been made to feel so important as I have, and as I have today, but I've been pampered and escorted. Sabra Guerra and Karen Horak have helped me so much during the day. I want to recognize another person. When I came here a few years ago on doing the research to write the Rudder book, and I spent quite a bit of time in the Dick Smith Library, and there was a person there who I hope is here tonight, Glenda Stone. I cannot help but recognize Glenda. And where is she? There she is, back over there, Glenda. Glenda is not only a truly a professional librarian who is oriented toward helping patrons of the library. She is, I can assure you, she's an archivist. She knows what's in the library, the rare books and papers. She's a genealogist, and she is an expert on Erath County cemeteries and barbecue because she took me around to them. Okay. Anyway, thank you very much, Glenda, for what you've done. Well, let me get started, and let me tell you my plan for the evening. I want you to know more about Rudder, and I have a PowerPoint presentation. I will go through some of it rather quickly. My intention is for you to know more about him and his life, and I will be emphasizing that really the roots or the importance of Tarleton to Rudder and his extraordinary accomplishments. And once that is done, I think what we want is a question and answer period. And I may go a little faster than you would like for me to go, but maybe I won't be going fast enough for some of you. You know, if you happen to get through before I do, well, it's okay if you decide to make your departure. But at any rate, I love coming to Tarleton, and Tarleton is historic in a number of ways, but it goes way back in its history as being the student-centered institution. I know a man, student-centered in being understanding and helpful to students, and at the same time insisting that they master their subject matter. I know, for example, a man who has a degree from Tarleton in agricultural economics. And I asked him, why did you major in agricultural economics? He said, I didn't major in agricultural economics. I majored in freshman chemistry, because he had to take freshman chemistry over and over again before he could finally get a degree in agricultural economics. So, but there he is. I consider that the alma mater, truly. That's the way we think of our universities, the nourishing mother, the other mother. And that's what Tarleton was in a very real sense for Earl Rudder. Rudder epitomizes the American success story. He was an impoverished country boy whose basic values were taught by a deeply religious mother, and he developed great character. He got a handhold on the law, on the wall of life here at Tarleton. He completed his degree at A&M. He went on, he worked hard, he was stoic, he put up with a lot. Life was a struggle, life was difficult. In fact, he failed at Tarleton. Tarleton, then a two-year college, required 3 years because the first year he had to leave. He utterly failed. It was humiliating. But he never really failed again. But he goes on into life, and he thrives because other people, older people, see promise in him. They're impressed with him and the way that he handles responsibility. His contemporaries and younger men here at Tarleton High School in the Army during the war, they wanted to follow him. They wanted to be with him. And he became an extraordinary agent of power wherever he chose to be. And yet he never lost touch with his roots and with his childhood friends in Texas, in rural Texas. It's a remarkable achievement, of which Tarleton is so much a part of it. He could not have done it without getting a handhold on the wall of life here at Tarleton. He became a very wise and good man. And good men and women who exercise power are really the most fascinating of all kinds of people. So let us sort of get started with the story of Earl Rudder. And in the first of these PowerPoint slides, actually there are two of them. They're a list of significant places, things, what that are named for Rudder. That one got advanced when I didn't intend it to be. That is the second of two slides. He is memorialized in other countries, three in France that I know of, two in England, one in Germany. The final stage of Ranger training in the U.S. Army training in Florida is known as Camp Rudder. And I'll tell you more about that in a moment. Task Force Rudder in a small village in Luxembourg, that little small, very small country that's just south of Belgium. Task Force Rudder liberated them from the Nazi domination on Christmas Eve, 1944. Now, Rudder is very likely in this photograph, which some of you may recognize, taken in 1928 while he was a student here. It's possible that he's not in the photograph because he really failed that first year. He failed and he had to go home. But let me tell you, he stayed here long enough in the fall of 1927, that would lead into the year, into the spring of 28. He stayed long enough to play in all of the football games. And then through some kind of magic, he withdrew without really ruining his record completely. And he went home to Eden. He had to go home. He went home because he had, you know, as today, the kids come home because they need a place to eat. And that was Rudder in that time. He had to have a place to eat. So he went home. I'm learning to advance this, I hope to. Can you advance from up there? Okay. The two great figures in Rudder's life, the Mayo figures, were both men he encountered here at Tarleton. J. Thomas Davis was the president at the time and the famous coach for the period. W.J. Wisdom is on the right. Davis became a sort of a role model that Rudder would think of. He's more distant to Rudder than Coach Wisdom was. Davis is the role model for Rudder, who became the president of a university. And he would always talk about these two men. Wisdom is that great that coach who between 1934 and 1938 won what the 86 consecutive basketball games, 110 out of 111, remarkable record. He found Rudder in Eden, Texas, you see. Wisdom was also a great ethical teacher. His ethic, which you will hear from me again and again, and he kept a poster in the men's dressing room, was a great line from a sports writer by the name of Grantland Rice. And that is that for when the one great scorer comes to mark against your name, he cares not whether you've won or lost, but how you played the game. How you played the game. Now, I will come back also to that quotation, but here I want to show you something made an impression on me, and I don't, and I've tried to explain to people why it made such an impression on me, and I'll try again tonight. Several years ago, right after the Rudder biography came out, the Army invited me to Camp Rudder in Florida, in the panhandle of Florida. And when I got there, and that is the highlight image there in the slide, is Rudder. And there are two other figures that we did a Photoshop, little Photoshop work on this, but they fade in the background. But whoever put this slide together got it exactly right. They showed Rudder at the top of the pyramid. He is a superior person. He is more than a soldier. He is a great human being. He has great personal skills. He has vision. He is not just brawn. He is brains. The other two are great soldiers, to be sure. But the Army and the Rangers in particular, when they had to select a name for the final stage of Ranger training, they went all the way back to Rudder. It's a very interesting training camp. There are a lot of swamps in the area. And one of the rules in that training camp is you don't harm the snakes and the reptiles because they're all part of the training. Because the next class that comes through will need, they will be trained in how to deal with those, with the snakes and the alligators that are all out there in the swamps. So that is Camp Rudder, where he is recognized as the model ranger. Next. This is his birthplace, Eden, Texas. Now, one way of explaining where Eden is, it's in the direction of Brownwood and about twice the distance. And it's at the time he was born and was in this period, 1910 to 1920, had a population of about 600. If you look very carefully on one of the storefronts, you can almost make out the Rudder on it. But his father was, as they said in the town, his father was a commission man. He got by, and by his livelihood was by whatever he could sell or whatever he could buy and make a small profit on it, whether it was land, whether it was commodities, that is grain, cattle, whatever it was. But that's what it was like. And those are not electric power line poles. Well, they may be, but if there was electric power in Eden, it was only through the business part of the little town, because there was no electricity in the town until Rudder was 10 years old, which would have been in 1925. My point of it is that he grew up in difficult circumstances, as most kids did in his time. They grew up accepting the difficulties with which they would have to cope. The Greeks have a word for people like who have those qualities, who accept the difficulties in their lives and just plow, go on through. They're called stoic. They put up with it. They may want to change, but they deal and they accept the difficulties of their life. Next, please. There's a family. He's the infant. His mother, gave birth to 13 children, six of whom lived to adulthood, all six of whom were boys. At one stage in her life, she gave birth to triplets who were born in 1 3-day period, and all were still born. The mother was the strength of the family. There's no doubt about it. The father was not a bad fellow. The father just never found his niche. And his father came along at a time in Texas and Reconstruction after the Civil War. There's very little opportunity. The point I'm wanting to make with this slide about the father is that Earl did not have a positive father figure, and W.J. Wisdom, his coach at Tarleton became the father figure that he did not have at home. Right. The mother is the devout believer in the Holy Book. In her reading room in her home, and I was able to interview a woman 95 years old who had worked in the home helping Mrs. Rudder when she took in boarders. On the table beside Mrs. Rudder's favorite chair, there were two books. The one was the Holy Book, and the other one was the Information Highway of the time, which was the Sears and Roebuck catalog. Okay. And so Mrs. Rudder around Eden was sometimes called her own walking concordance. You know what that means? She's like a walking reference book, herself, to the Holy Book, that is, to the Bible. Give her a cite of passage to her, and she could tell you where to go for it, or tell you what was in a certain passage. She is the strength of the family, and there Earl is as an infant. Here he is at age 4 in Eden. Next, yeah. Eden's first football team. It is football which gets him, finally allows him to leave Eden, as few boys were. The first football team, the fall of 1925, and you see him there. We've circled his image there in the photograph. Football, from the time he plays football, that is his love. And he comes to Eden, he comes to Tarleton, believing that he would have scholarships, and he did. Very informal scholarships that I will talk about a little later on. Next. Here he is when he finished high school, and when W.J. Wisdom found him, age 17, when he came to Tarleton. His father did not want him to go to college. Earl had a job he was a clerk in a drugstore. His father said, "You are already making more money than I was when I married your mother. You do not need to go to college." But his mother told him, and almost in biblical terms, to keep moving toward the light, moving toward the light. What is that? That's education, elucidation. It's learning. So he decides to take a chance that he will trust this man, W.J. Wisdom. And so he packs all of his belongings in one suitcase, one cardboard suitcase, wearing the only pair of shoes that he has. He goes out to the highway in Eden. He hitchhikes to Brady. And then from there, he hitchhikes on through all the little towns of Blanket and Comanche. Actually, it was a lot of fun, I want to tell you, when I had to research what the roads were like. Leading into Stephenville and all the way back down to Brady and towards San Angelo, research what the roads were in 1927 when he hitchhiked it. And the only part of the road that really had been improved was about the first 5 miles now going out of Stephenville. That's how he got here. He couldn't come any other way. If he'd have tried to come on a train, which was available, it cost $6. But he had less than $100 in his pockets. But W.J. Wisdom had encouraged him to come. This is a 17-year-old boy who arrived at Tarleton, penniless, poorly prepared, as he would say throughout his life. Next. Well, there he is. Look at him. He always had $1 million. He had $1 million smile. It was one of his gifts. I found an inscription in the grass burr for one of the years that he was here from one of the players that he was a boy that even on the football field, and they didn't have turf. They played on dirt. Okay. That even when he came up with a mouthful of dirt, he still came up with a smile on his face. He was so happy. That had curly brown curly hair. When he arrived here, as best I can determine, he did not know a single person except for Coach W.J. Wisdom. It's quite possible that some of the other kids who were here had seen him play, had seen him on a football field, but he did not know anyone else, anyone at all. Well, he enjoyed it so much that, as I mentioned earlier, he managed to stay in school just long enough to get through the football season. Then he went home and got a job working on a road crew, the road which was from Eden to Menard, if anybody happens, if you know where that is. So there he is, and you may recognize even the buildings. But I come back again, as I will, perhaps more than you would like for me to. When he gets here and he encounters this fellow Wisdom. Wisdom is not only a coach in sports, he's a coach about life. He's a mentor. He's a teacher, counselor, as well as a role model. And this inscription he has as a poster in the men's dressing room. There's another part, there are many aspects of this quotation. And I want to tell you, just think about it analytically. The very end of it, how you played the game. How you played the game. It's not only how hard you played, or with how much determination that you played, but how did you play relative to your teammates? Were you loyal and supportive of them? Did you play in a way that maximized your efforts, the team efforts to succeed or to gain attention for yourself? Were you fair to your teammates? And how did you treat your coaches? Did you respect your coaches? And how about the officials? How about the officials? Did you respect the officials? There's some wonderful photographs in the grass berths bar a little later on, and when Rudder returned to here as the head football coach, of how dignified he was on the sidelines during the games and sitting on a bench. There's a great story also when he was president of Texas A&M. And A&M had a winning football team. They then had a famous coach by the name of Gene Stallings. A&M was playing Texas Tech in College Station. And A&M was losing. And one of the calls by an official, an infraction on A&M, was because Gene Stallings lost his temper and ran out onto the field during the game, and the umpire penalized him, and it was a 15-yard penalty. Now, luckily for Stallings, A&M eventually went on and won the game. But he, Coach Gene Stallings, who later would coach a national championship team at Alabama, Gene Stallings ran out on the field. Stallings told me the story after the book came out, so you won't find it in the book. I know you just can't wait to get your hands on the book, you see. But he told me this, that he felt good that next Monday morning he went to his office, and about 9 o'clock, his secretary answered the telephone and came in and said, Coach Stallings, President Rudder wants to see you. And Stallings thought, well, that was just Rudder wanted to congratulate him, and Stallings put on his coat and he started to go to the president's office. And the secretary said, no, he's coming to see you. When Stallings ran out onto the field, he also shouted some nasty words at the official. And Rudder came to Stallings' office. He did not come in and sit down. He came in, and he came just over the threshold of the door and looked at Stallings, and he said, Coach, when I hired you, we did not hire you to run out onto the field and cuss out the umpire or cuss out the referee. So I mentioned that while there's a university president sitting here, that sometimes you may have to say what you do. I mean, you come down on the football coach, and I come from a university where we pay football coaches millions of dollars, but yet the authority still rests with the president, okay? But how you played the game when that one great scorer comes to mark against your name next. Before Rudder left here, transferring to A&M in 1930, he went to see J. Thomas Davis. J. Thomas Davis wrote a little note to him, and it expressed, Thomas expressed his dedication to Tarleton. And that's all there was to it. Somebody wanted me, all there was to it was something to do, something to love, something to live for. And one of my editors in working on this book on Rudder recommended making this the title of the book, something to do, something to love, something to live for. That was Davis's attitude about Tarleton. And then one of your other great alums and a friend of mine named Joe Long. Joe was here at the time when J. Thomas Davis was the president. And Joe made this statement about Davis, that he was a man of such character that you recognized it immediately upon meeting him for the first time. And he's one of those who built Tarleton. Next. Well, when Rudder came back, and he was a success. Those, like, he failed the first year, came back the next 2 years, and he goes in and he's accepted into this Lucky 13 club. And this is from the Grass Burr in 1930. You can tell he's, what a great smile, what a happy guy, happy fellow he is. He had a party on the 13th day of every month. It's marvelous, you see. Made fun of suspicious objects like black cats. Let's go on. Next. You've already seen that enough from me today. But I want to tell you, in passing that, the girls here at Tarleton loved him so much, liked him. And I found a number of quotes and notes that they would write to him. And I want to read you just two or three of some things that they wrote to him. And I read it to you because I also was once 20 years old, you see? And I know what this would do to a boy and the memories, the fond memories that it would leave to him about Tarleton. One girl wrote, "Whenever I think of Tarleton, I'll always think of Rudder." So for her life, she would think of Rudder. And then, and going further, another girl wrote him and thanked him for encouraging her to return to college. Quote, "Every time I think of what this year has meant to me, I think that for you, I might not have put forth the effort to come back." Another acknowledged that she never expected to see him again. And then she added, "I can honestly say I've never gone with any boy who treated me any nicer than you." And yet another, at the end of 2 years of infatuation, thanked him for not taking advantage of her affection. Isn't that an amazing thing? Okay. She declared, "I am proud we didn't break. We didn't break any of John's old rules, such as out after hours, car riding, and dates other than on campus." And yet another complained that he declined her invitation to a picnic. And she added, "You went out and played football instead of going with me to the picnic." And he was not really indifferent to them. But that was the period of the flappers. And there's a writer that you may know of, F. Scott Fitzgerald, who wrote about flappers. And of flappers, he described them as lovely, expensive, and about 19. And so they are at that fact that they were expensive, and the fact that Rudder didn't have any money also helps explain why he didn't pursue them, why he didn't have a serious girlfriend while he was in college. But also, he was more interested in football. Next. Here he is, quickly, when he made the varsity team at A&M. And the next is when he was commissioned as a first lieutenant, graduating from ROTC at A&M. And I want to go back and forth between these two photographs just a couple of times for you to see how erect he stands, how similar he is in each of those, in each of the photographs. So we go back here. And I found old Aggies who would remember him from this period. And they described him in this way, that he always had his cap on straight, that he was very proper. And so we're going to see this again and again. You even can see him when he's in combat or in combat gear in World War II, and his hat is on straight. He is a proper man in that sense. First job coaching and teaching at Brady High School, 1933-38. Marriage in 1937. Next. And then the break of his life, he returned to Tarleton as a head football coach and a teacher in the fall of 1938. And he would be here until he was called to active duty at the beginning of World War II. He was called to active duty in June. I think when he got back, he wanted to come back to Tarleton so much. When he got here, I think he never intended to leave. He bought a small house right outside the historic gates and bought some lots where I think he intended to build a larger home. He started taking graduate courses at TCU. I think he wanted to be like J. Thomas Davis or W.J. Wisdom. This Tarleton was the place that was the most dear to him. This is where he wanted to be. And so you see this, here is his hat as he appeared in 1940. More can I tell you about this photograph? So, and he has a very good record here. After the book came out, well, one of the bane of an author, when the book, that people began coming to me and tell me stories because they'd read the book, they tell me stories, and I think, my gosh, why didn't you come to me before, you know, so I could put it in the book, but obviously they couldn't. But one is, a woman came up to me after I'd given talk, a book review, and she said that he had taught her tennis here at Tarleton, and she didn't remember anything about tennis that he taught. What she remembered was how grateful he was for the job, how grateful he was to be here. I mean, when you have been through, in this time, 1940, and you have lived through the Great Depression, and you have been in the lived in deprivation as he had, when he graduated from college in 1932, and there were no jobs available, and he got a job working on the road crew, and then he was able to come to Tarleton. This is where he wanted to be. Right. Next, the war comes, and by the late 1942, he is a major. See, the hat is on properly. That little elastic band, which went around through the top, that became fashionable to remove the elastic band, and so your cap would kind of flop down, become a little floppy. It looked casual. That was never for Rudder. This was taken when he at Fort Leavenworth, Kansas, in late 1942. Next. Now I'll let you look at that pair of dog tags. Just look at them for a moment. In the third line down, you see the name of his brother. Now, if you have ever had, maybe you still have, ever had a dog tag, would you raise your hand? I'm one of them. And on the dog tag, that third line down is the next of kin. Ordinarily, the person to be notified and something terribly unfortunate happens to you. But he did not want that telegram, that dreadful telegram, to come to his home and to be received by his wife, who was in Brady, Texas, with two small children. These dog tags would have been made just before he went to Europe. He went to Europe in November of 43, and so these would have been made about the previous month. So what he did, he had a brother who lived in Brady, who was a pharmacist, and who lived down the street from where Margaret Rudder lived with her two children. So he put his brother's name on the name tag so that if he were killed, that brother John Rudder would receive the notice, and brother John Rudder could then go and break the news to Mrs. Rudder. Very gracious act. Next. This is along a harbor in southern England, on the English Channel. He is in the front on the right side. I have sat in that very place. There's a monument near there now that has his name on it, and they're marching to their landing craft to load up to go to Normandy, June 1st, 1944. Next. This is a historic photograph. Historic, I say it's historic, because that's how he regarded it. An unusual photograph taken with a Brownie camera, one of the few that were taken in the ordeal where they were isolated, cut off, and stranded at this place called Point du Hoc. It's just very typical. Again, the hat is on there perfectly straight. I and others have examined this photograph more in great detail with magnifying glasses, trying to find other things, among other things, his pistol. But I'm quite sure that it's under the map case, which is on his right side. The object over to the left on the tripod is a signal lantern that actually was a World War I, used in World War I for communications, but he, Rudder, or someone with him, did not trust their radios, and so they took the signal lantern for their emergency communications. Next. And this is, again, very nearly the same place, and is taken the next day. And Rudder is at the very top center of the photograph, just to the left and above the American flag. The American flag is located there, so that friendly planes flying over would recognize that these were friendly troops down below them and not fire on them. But Rudder's there, and the men standing in front of him are actually German prisoners. And he is shouting at them. I know that because some of the men down below could still remember. And he's shouting at them to put their hands up. He thinks he's saying hands up, but he didn't study German while he was here or at A&M, and he's really telling them to put their hands down, and they don't know what to do. He's shouting, put their hands up, but he's telling them to put them down. Okay. Again, another famous photograph. Next. And today you go there, and there's a monument erected by the French. On the right side is a piece of granite that represents a dagger, and the hilt of it here on the left side is in English. The other side is in French. It is very interesting that only one name appears there in both French and English, and that name is Rudder. And it's because he stayed in the area for a few days. He had a very humane person to how he treated French civilians after the 4 years that they had lived under the oppression of the Nazi occupiers. And so when the French put up the monument, they put his name on it, and they got it exactly right. Point du Hoc in Normandy. Next. This is a few days later. He has his whole battalion, what's left of it. They're all out in front of him. It's very much like him. An open and direct communication with subordinates. They were surprised to see him because he had been shot. He had been wounded twice on June the 6th or June the 7th. And there he was standing in front of them, looking hale and hearty, and he is listening to their concerns. This would be somewhere around June the 10th or the 12th. There you, but it's very typical. And he knew, one of the good things about him was that he knew to ask people to help him, including his subordinates, help him, or he would ask for their opinions, their judgments in going forward. And next. There's a famous book and a famous movie by the same name. It's called The Longest Day. You ever seen The Longest Day movie? 3 hours long, fabulous, some of the most great performers, actors of the time. It came out in 1961. It was written by a man named Cornelius Ryan. And Cornelius Ryan sent Rudder a questionnaire when he was starting to write the book. I think I counted, I got the copy of the questionnaire from the Oberlin College archives. I think Ryan asked him 21 questions. He asked Rudder 21 questions, and Rudder answered them with 26 words. He's the bane of historians, me, because he never cared about history. He didn't care about getting the credit. He was never looking back. He was always looking forward, looking toward the future. So, and I just put it as a sample. You say, like, were you wounded? Yes, twice. The last question, do you recall any incident, sad or heroic, memorable, that struck you more than anything else? Answer, no. You see, so he got no information from him. Right. So when the book is written, Rudder and his Rangers, who had done so much, they're not recognized. Well, they're there. They're barely there. And then when when the movie came out, it's a crime against history. A crime against history, the way they are misrepresented as a bunch of buffoons, awkward, who don't know what they're doing when they really were very professional and they were led by a true professional. Thought you'd like to see this verbatim from the interview. Next, please. The German Colonel Martin First. Martin First was a very lucky fellow, because he was taken prisoner by Earl Rudder. This happened out in the Brittany Peninsula, you know, that long peninsula that extends out into the Atlantic Ocean from France. And First was increasingly got in a desperate situation. He was surrounded. He and his men were surrounded. One of Rudder's men had broken into a fortress where Martin First was. And then Rudder decides to go to see First. He wants to persuade First to surrender all the Germans in the area, not just 200 or so who were in the immediate vicinity where First was. But Rudder wants him to surrender something like more than 2,000 soldiers. So Rudder goes up to see him. And I've been to the place. There's a monument beside the road now. The monument is dated, for the date of the surrender was September the 9th, 1944. Martin First is on the edge of the great abyss of his life. He does not know what will happen to him. He knows he's going to be taken prisoner. Okay. And here is this American soldier, a commander, among the toughest of the soldiers. And Martin First does not know whether he is an ignorant, blockhead, fanatic, or what kind of a person he is. And Rudder comes walking up to him. First stands in the doorway. And let me tell you, I know all of this because 10 years later, exactly 10 years later, First sat down to write his memoir, and he described the day. And I found Martin First's son living in Mainz, Germany, and got the memoir from him. So Colonel First is there. Rudder comes walking up to him. First is fluent in English, and Rudder says to him, "Well, you're the guy we've been looking for all this time." And immediately engages him in conversation, sits down with him. It's as though, well, how you played the game. He's going to be fair. He has empathy. He has understanding with the other person. And he wants Martin First to surrender all of the Germans and all the troops under his command in the area. And Martin First finally agrees. And when First sits down 10 years later to write his memoir, the very first line is, he wants to thank with all his heart the generosity and the chivalry of the Ranger commander who came to him that day, on the day, the most humiliating day of his life, came for that surrender. Okay. Next. This is leading the Liberation Parade in a place called Colmar, France. Notice that the helmet is on his head, perfectly straight, and the sergeant behind him is skewed to the side, and the fellow over to on the other side is similarly, but Rudder is proper. Next. Next. He goes home. He gets home 2 days before Christmas, 1945. He's in a great quandary of his life. He is committed to return to Tarleton. He cannot decide what to do. Will he stay in Brady, or will he come back here to Tarleton? His personal possessions are still stored in the gymnasium. He thought he would only be gone 1 year. He stored them here. He left them here, and he cannot decide what to tell Dean Davis, President Davis, as to whether he's coming back or not. I also learned after the book came out that Davis wanted Rudder to become president. He wanted Rudder to succeed him. He talked about it in his office. If only Rudder would come back, Davis would not retire. Davis would put off his retirement another year or two. In fact, he would retire the following spring. And finally, Rudder decides that he will stay in Brady. People want him to become mayor, and he's elected to 6 years that he served as mayor in Brady. That's the first time, the first. Next slide. And then he is selected to be the land commissioner for the state of Texas. The governor, they had a vacating, an opening of the previous commissioner, had resigned. It's a statewide elected office. And so he appointed Rudder to that, and Rudder then ran for statewide office. He was elected on his own to be commissioner of the General Land Office. That didn't last very long. It was there only about 3 years. I worked there. I was an undergraduate at the time, so I saw him coming and going. I can assure you he did not know who I was. I was once on an elevator with him, just the two of us. It was terribly embarrassing for me. I couldn't say anything. I didn't say anything, and how I wished I had thought of something I could have asked him, but I was only 20 years old myself, and I didn't know how my life would unfold. So there he is, his commissioner. Then he goes to A&M, next. And here is inaugurated as president of A&M, where he becomes best known, and many people just do not believe this, that A&M was once all male and all military. All male, all military. And it's now like Tarleton. There's more women at A&M than there are men. But when Rudder went there, it was all male, and that was a very important part of the old Aggie culture. And it was he who had the stature and the influence to see that it was changed, And he was the transformative president of Texas A&M. And that went on. He was president from 1958 until 1970.
Right.
Here he's inaugurated. And next is the presidential family. Next. He was great friends with President Lyndon Johnson, who was president most of the time, and president of the United States most of the time. The Rudder was president of A&M, and that helps explain the great boost in research funding that A&M got during that period because Rudder was so close to LBJ. And next, he was also a great friend with Governor John Conley, and Conley was governor during most of that period. So it's a happy coincidence of the alignment of the constellations there. And then finally, well, he loved being with students. His life that he had learned, the life, what he discovered here at Tarleton, the two great things that he wanted to do with his life, one was to be with young people, and the other was with the military. Those are the discoveries that shaped his entire life, and it happened right here on this campus. So here he is in the dormitory with A&M students. And next, he goes to Boys Ranch, again with young people. And next, he's the chairman of the statewide, heads up the March of Dimes drive. And next. And here he is going to a Ranger reunion 23 years after the war's over. And look at the adoration on the faces of those other men looking at him, and that great million-dollar smile that one of his fellow football players described, that I mentioned earlier, while he's here at Tarleton, coming up with a mouthful of dirt, and he still has a great smile on his face. So there you have it, with those still adoring him. And next, and there you finally have it. He ends up. He died while he's in office. And one of his eulogies, and I'll end with this. In one of his eulogies from a man who was with him throughout the war, we know of no man who has worn the mantles of leadership and humility at the same time. He personified the Good Samaritan. He was fair-minded and he was honorable. He could be trusted. And we believed in him. He was a man you would die for. Thank you.
Oh, thank you so much, Dr. Hatfield. I feel a little bit like I watched the movie before the book, and I've got to go back and read all those details that I missed the first time I read the book. It was amazing. Thank you so much. Now you, the audience, has a chance to ask Dr. Hatfield some questions. Dr. Kyle McGregor, will you please join us? I'm going to sign off now and turn this over to Dr. McGregor, who is going to facilitate our Q&A time up here. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Donna. Janice Horak has a microphone, and she will bring it to you so you can ask a question, but I'm going to take liberty, and I'm going to ask Dr. Hatfield to tell a brief story that he told today during lunch, and I've heard him tell his story numerous times, and I'm taking liberty because I am a Tarleton graduate. I'm alumni. I like to hear him say this about... Tell us about him beginning his professional career and ending his professional career.
You know, I have real difficulty telling the same story in the same way twice. Beginning and ending his professional career, let me talk about here. Okay. I say that Earl Rudder was first and last a Tarleton product. A Tarleton man, because the coming out, the beginning of his adult life was when he arrived here as a 17-year-old. That was breaking away from home. That took a great deal of courage. That was the beginning of his adulthood here. Then, at the very end of his life, and actually the day that was the last day of his active professional life, he came to Tarleton, and he spent the day in the Trogdon House. And let's see, the Trogdon son is here. He's here. And you were there that day, were you not? And your mother, he loved your mother and your father. And your mother was Flo and Bill. And he also loved your mother's kitchen, what came out of her kitchen. And what in that period, that was a very difficult period for him, for Rudder as president of Texas A&M. Because it was a time of student disorders, it was a time of unrest, faculty dissensions. A&M ended up being put on losing their accreditation, and went on for several years. And so Rudder would have wanted to get away from College Station, and the place he most wanted to be was here on the Tarleton campus. So that morning, he had access as the chancellor of the A&M system. He had access to a small plane. So he flew up here and stayed the whole day here on the campus and in the Trogdon House. And Bill Trogdon, or Bill, what was there during that day. So there, in the most literal sense, he is first and last a Tarleton man.
Janice, do we have any takers for questions? Ladies and gentlemen, the format will be, you'll pose the question, and I will repeat for Dr. Hatfield, and then hand the mic to him.
Not a question, but to ask you if you would say a little more about the controversy when he was leading A&M to admit females for the first time.
The question is, talk a little bit more about the admission of ladies to Texas A&M and how that affected Rudder.
The controversy over whether women should be allowed to enroll at A&M on the same basis as men had gone on for decades. It had been in the courts. Legislation either for it or to deny it, or to deny women the right, had been introduced in the legislature. And it was always highly inflammatory. It was obvious to many progressive thinkers, of whom Rudder was one, and to five of the nine members of the A&M Board of Regents who believed that women should be admitted on the same basis as men. They were admitting women in various categories. If you were the daughter or the wife of a professor or an employee at A&M, you could enroll. But let's say that you lived in Dallas and your father worked for the Texas Highway Department, then you couldn't enroll in A&M. There were categories, and A&M was in decline. I mean, this is early 60s, when other institutions are rising and rising rapidly as the first of the post-war sort of baby boomers are beginning to arrive on the campuses. University of Houston is relatively new, at that time was still private, at 17,000 students. Texas Tech was rising rapidly with 15 to 16,000. UT Austin, 24,000. And A&M was about 8,000 and all male, or nearly all male. Rudder said, Earl made a statement to his wife, and she repeated it to me. If A&M does not change, it will become less important than the smallest junior college. Wow, Ranger Junior College, you know. So that was a kind of image that he had. So he thought out, he wanted to try to get this done in the least controversial way. And it was done very quietly. It was not done in the courts. It was not done in the legislature. It went for an opinion from the Attorney General, where it could be thought out, not in the political arena, but thought out legally, and that it was unconstitutional to deny women this right. It was not the Civil Rights Act of 1964. It wasn't that. It was basic constitutional rights, you know, of the U.S. Constitution. And so the Attorney General came down with that opinion. It was hardly, the only newspaper I could find it in was the Fort Worth Star-Telegram, a little small little article, and the writer, whose name was Sam Kinch, he misunderstood it. He thought the courts had reaffirmed the Attorney General's decision, but the Attorney General's judgment, opinion it is, but he hadn't. And so eventually the A&M came to, the A&M board came to accept women in a very strange way, and they left it, the decision, 100% with Rudder. It took them months to arrive at this decision. The first part of the admissions policy, again, they end up admitting women on the same basis as men, but the first part of the admissions policy had all of the previous exclusions and categories under which women could be admitted. And then at the very last little provision was that anyone else, any other person, or any person that will keep A&M in compliance with the Attorney General's opinion. You get that? And that was left up to the decision of President Rudder. Well, when they adopted that, he went from there to his office and issued a memorandum, admit any woman who applies and who meets all the qualification. And that's how it happened. They put it in his hands, exactly in his hands. Is that fair? It's an extraordinary thing. They reaffirmed the illegal, but then they overrode it with the final provision, leaving it up to President Rudder. I bet some of you young people just cannot believe that there was a time when women were not allowed to be enrolled in Texas A&M. That's what they say to me. They say they just shake their head. They don't believe it.
Yes, sir. Yeah, back here in the back. My name is Art Hernandez. I'm a sophomore here, class of 2019. I just had a question. So Dr. Rudder, he was a president at A&M University at one time. Much like our president here, Dr. Dontavio, what were some things he did to connect with the students and get really student-focused while his time there at A&M?
While he was president at Texas A&M, what were some of the things that he did to connect directly with students during his presidency?
Well, it was very direct. And any number of people would tell me stories like this. It'd be walking across the campus. Be walking across the campus, and he might stop them and talk to them and ask them how they were doing and what their major was and where they were from. It was always full of these questions. They were kind of questions that, I mean, you know, I've been a college president for 8 years, and President Dovitano, you've been here 8 years, and they would be illegal for us to ask now because they would be considered invasions of privacy. but he would ask them all kind of questions, and he basically had an open door to his office. It had to be regulated, and you have Bill Royal as your father, right? And your father and mother were at A&M in this period at the time when women were going to be admitted, and your father, Bill Royal, an undergraduate, walked in his office and told him that he was ruining Texas A&M, that he was a traitor. Okay, so it was very direct. Another thing he did, he thought that he was a very moral person. I didn't tell the story tonight, but the story that means a lot to me. I think he's a moral and proper person. He was not a vulgar person, and even those tough Rangers, he would caution them not to use vulgar language within the earshot of children.
Okay,
right. And he didn't do that himself. His son tells me he only heard him use a certain vulgar term one time in his entire life. But he thought it was, he had a moral duty to protect those boys, those young men at Texas A&M from the corruption, the broader corruption of society. So there are certain things he didn't want them to do. He didn't want them going to big Eastern universities after they, when they graduated. He was not for that. The students made a contract for Johnny Cash to come to the campus. And not long after, they made a contract with Johnny Cash to come and perform on the campus. Well, Johnny Cash was stopped in the El Paso airport. He had several hundred amphetamines in his possession, and Earl canceled the contract. And the students, because it was his duty to protect the students from immoral influences. How else did he do that? Did he interact with students? One thing, from day one, he was opposed to hazing. That is horrible traditions of hazing. You see, I was sort of brought up to thinking that I was supposed to go to A&M. Well, I can tell you that I didn't want to go to a place where they had hazing like that. And I didn't want to go to a place where there weren't any girls, you know. So, absolutely true. I went. I worked out with the baseball team in the spring of my senior year, and I've never forgot being in the athletic dormitory, Hart Hall. Stayed there overnight. We're there in one of those days, and all of a sudden, every fellow in that dormitory ran to one side, began looking out the windows. If it had been a ship, it would have capsized. And what happened? There were three girls walked along the sidewalk on the, you know. So I didn't want to go to a place like that. But he insisted he was an academic fundamentalist. Probably went back to his own failure in academics, that he thought you had, he wanted, he always asked people what their GPA was, and he tried to put a stop to any kind of hazing, anything that interfered with students' ability to study. Is that fair enough?
Ladies and gentlemen, we have time for one more question.
So we know that he had strong ties, obviously, with Tarleton and A&M, but were there any other universities that he was involved with, like UT or anything?
So the question is, Rudder obviously has strong ties with Tarleton and Texas A&M. Were there other universities that he was involved with?
I'm embarrassed to have to tell you the story. And then I will ask myself a question. The other university with which he had very strong ties was the University of Texas at Austin. And that originated with Mrs. Rudder. Mrs. Rudder was a 1936 graduate of the University of Texas. She had been very active there. She had been popular. She had been selected by the dorm counselor. She stayed in a famous old dorm called Littlefield Dorm, and she was selected, asked to stay there by the counseling staff. And she was also into the student organization, the university council, or whatever it was called. And there she became very good friends with a fellow named John Conley, who would then become governor in the 1960s. She met in a sort of distant way another future governor whose name was Alan Shivers. And it was Shivers who really moved Rudder into, as I pointed out, appointed him commissioner of the General Land Office. Her best friend, other than her male friend for her entire life, from her college days, was a man by the name of Jake Pickle. And Jake Pickle was a congressman from Central Texas, the 10th district, of which Austin was the center of it. He eventually became a congressman from there for 31 years. Jake was a poor boy who lived in Big Spring, and Mrs. Rudder and her family lived on a ranch near Menard, which is about halfway between Austin and Big Spring. So one of the ways that Jake Pickle and Mrs. Rudder became good friends is that on holidays, Mrs. Rudder's family, her parents, would drive in from Menard to pick her up. So Jake would ride with them back to Menard, and then he would hitchhike onto Big Spring. And so it was hours and hours of riding back and forth. And then when they returned to Austin, he did the similar thing. He would hitchhike to Menard, and he would ride on with them. Well, Jake became very influential, and he was in public relations. Obviously he's influential if he stays in Congress for 31 years. And even though he's a UT Austin person, he was very close to Earl and to Mrs. Rudder. I could go on about that and about how it really was Longhorn, University of Texas men who were Earl's boosters into statewide politics. They did it. It was not Aggies who did it. It was those Longhorns who did it. And although Lyndon Johnson never went to the University of Texas, his wife did, and Lyndon was a big booster. But Conley, Shiver, Johnson, and Pickle, all of those, they pushed Rudder into the limelight. He went to the annual Longhorn football banquet. I actually found a letter that someone wrote to him, sort of, it was jokingly, it was humorous, but that he had gone the previous day to the evening to the Longhorn football banquet, and he had sung The Eyes of Texas there with them. So he went to Longhorn football games. Okay. He admonished Aggies not to ridicule Longhorns. Now, there's some other reasons behind that. We know that anyway. But so that is the other university with which he was very closely involved. Hook 'em, by the way.
Let's thank Dr. Hatfield. Yeah. President Ottavio is coming up. We're going to make a special presentation to Dr. Hatfield quickly. So,
well, I think most of the people in the audience, and Dr. Hatfield, I know you know this as well. At Tarleton, we take very seriously the core values of this university. I'd ask a student to do this, but I don't want to embarrass anybody. But our six core values are tradition, integrity, civility, leadership, excellence, and service. And as part of the Rudder Way project that we have underway, that's going to be the, as I said at the beginning, the culmination of our centennial, there are going to be markers along Rudder Way that talk about each of those values and how General Rudder exhibited them in his life. And Dr. Hatfield has helped us with some Rudder quotes that express each of those core values as lived out by General Rudder. And so, Dr. Hatfield, what we want to do, what we do here at the university, when we find somebody that has exhibited those core values in a special way, they receive a presidential coin that have the core values on them. And for your contribution to making Rudder Way a reality with some very special quotes of a very special man, we want to present you with this set of core value coins and say thank you so very much for your service to Tarleton State University.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I told someone earlier in the day you can count me as a friend of Tarleton. And I want to tell you that it's been a great honor to spend this day here. I do apologize for those of you who had to listen to me three times today. It was the work that I did concerning Rudder, the research here, was an enriching experience for me. I am better for it. I am really better for what I came to learn about Tarleton and its influence on this, on a particular young man, and the limitless influences that it can have on other young people. I mean, you are the faculty, the supporters of Tarleton, are the people that make this a great country. And I thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much again for coming out. Dr. Hatfield will be available in the lobby. And if you do not have a copy of his book, there are some there for purchase, and he will be signing them. And I'm sure that there are several individuals that have their own copy, and he'll be willing to sign those as well. Thank you again, and have a wonderful evening.